So you want to play better hockey, just not being taught the way that they're intended to be, or that maybe you're just not getting something that you probably should be getting, but you're not. But you see these other players who are getting it and you're like, why can't I be like them? Well, this series is for you, because I was in that same boat. For a long time, I wondered why I couldn't be just like the best players in hockey. And while I don't have the absolute perfect solution, I have something that is very close. I would say about 90 to 95% of what you need to do as far as opening up your body's ability, whether that's on ice performance or the stuff that you do in the gym. And that opens up the very possibility of you becoming the player of your dreams. This is a 5-part series. Today we are covering skating. And for me to give a proper demonstration of what the hell I'm actually talking about, we need to go take a look at it in video. So here is what I know about skating today that I wish I knew when I was 12 years old. I think everybody knows that skating is very complex, and it's because it's very different from just walking on the ground. You have to do something different in a super stiff boot on a slippery surface that has a blade basically about an eighth of an inch thick, and you're actually only on a fraction of a part of that blade in addition to, you know, the small radius that it has. So it's like, obviously skating is something that is very complicated. But what I wish I was taught sooner was looking at exactly myself versus an expert model. I think video would have helped to make some skills adjustments a hell of a lot quicker than I did maybe for the first 10 years that I was practicing all these skills and going to the power skating classes or the skills coaches who I was working with, or even the stuff that I was doing off the ice. That is something I would have died for to have a lot sooner, was that concept of video feedback. And this is going to show up again in the rest of these videos too, that theme of video feedback. Because what that allows you to do is look at yourself in addition to being able to coach yourself finally. Much like I can't see myself on the camera right now, I can't see where exactly I'm at this point in time. But if I paused the video, then I would then be able to see where exactly I'm at and maybe some adjustments I need to make to this same exact feedback mechanism works with hockey and with your skills training and even with some of your gym exercises. It works just as well there. That will be an overlaying theme in addition to the specific areas that we'll cover. So with skating, I think the biggest thing I wish I knew sooner was that it should take a lot less effort than I was originally taught it would, you know, take. Because in a way, if you look at how some of these best players play, including like the McDavids and the McKinnons, like maybe in this specific clip, he takes like one or two of those like bigger strides, if you want to call it bigger strides, and then he ends up gliding. Now, this glide was something I was never really taught, or even this little like wiggle that he does right here, that little wiggle right there. Basically, the fact that these guys glide way more often than not is something I wish a hell of a lot sooner. Like, he takes maybe a couple of those, and then right before he gets to the net, he's not striding right here at the top of the hash marks. Those aren't strides. Even something like this, where it's like one or two, but by the time he gets inside of the blue line, he, in quote, stops skating. It's like, what is going on there? I was taught that you had to just go hard all the time. But here you see this guy, like, being one of the more skilled players on the planet. He's gliding and basically not putting in any effort to skate fast. So what's going on there? It's the same thing with McDavid. And I could say it as well, it's the same thing with every other of the best skaters on the planet. So in layman's terms, it's the amount of effort that they need. Yeah, he's not skating hard right here. he's not skating hard right here. It's just like a little wide corkscrew, tripod, whatever you want to call it, that stance in that particular moment. And then he gets back up and he's nice and relaxed. Actually, if you look at these players skate in an isolated video, there are so many times where they just glide and they don't do like suicide, go line the blue line, or just stops and starts that you do it at the end of every practice for what is supposed to be conditioning, but it actually doesn't do that. Yet you see this guy who's the best player on the planet, he's constantly doing these little glides in addition to what he's doing with, you know, his drive wide guide, where he actually does, in quote, move his feet. So I think the thing there is that if you look at them a little more closely, you'll realize that common points, let's say, like constantly move your feet, or everything's a stop and start and north, south, or everything has to be like at 100% is not what these guys are doing. It's not what these best players are doing, I should say. And yeah, even in something little like this, it's like, oh, he stopped moving his feet. But it's like, well, did he or did he not? Because now he's going into a wide little tripod stance before he takes a shot. It's like, is that considered moving your feet? So this is like a more precise definition on what exactly that looks like. Is that in addition to them, let's say, bumping it up like you see in this first part, they have these moments where they do actually glide and don't really, let's say, move their feet all the time. Not that they need to. Let's give another example right here. That's a famous one. It's like he's gliding right here. Now you could say very easily that's like, oh, this depends on the situation. It always depends on the situation that they're in. To which, like, I don't think that argument is a good one. And here's why. I'm just studying their movement and trying to copy their movement. I don't give a flying fuck if it's different in situation to situation. You can remove the game of hockey from how these guys are moving to better learn how these guys are moving. Actually, this is what you're going to need to do for the rest of the series and as well. We have to distinguish in the hockey community and in the hockey training community that there is a big difference between the game of hockey and how to learn to move within the game of hockey. I am focusing solely on how to learn to move as a hockey player, not what the game of hockey is about. Everyone focuses on what the game of hockey is about in relation to, like, and I think they're doing that too much. I am focusing specifically on players' movement all around. That's what this series is all about. And skating is mastering skating, mastering the movements there, which everyone talks about. It's like, oh, you got to do power skating. You got to do power skating. You got to get faster. You got to master your skating. It's like, yes, but then you forget that if these players can't execute your tactics on the ice because they're bad at skating, because you're not teaching it properly compared to how these best players are skating, your tactics are probably not going to work. So that's the biggest point. It's like, regardless of tactics, regardless of the point of the game, you can still learn people's movement. And that's what we're doing here. So I might as well get into how you can learn some of these movements really quickly. So I'm going to use what my friends at Train 2.0 Hockey use with the skating pillars to distinguish what exactly we're looking at when we take a look at these players. So One of the first points to look at is the top hand positioning. You'll notice a lot of the time, like far more often than not, that the top hand is in tight to their hip. And even though it comes off the body occasionally, way more often than not, if we just take a look at this clip specifically, when McKinnon picks up the puck, it's like top hand goes to this area on his hip where his torso and the femur meet each other, like right at that hip. Train 2.0 calls it the Crosby crevice because Sidney Crosby does it all the time. It's what makes him so compact. It's also what makes him protect the puck a lot easier. But really what's happening here is that when, even though we're taught way more often than not to take the top hand off the body, we miss the fact that, let's say about 75% of the time to 90% of the time, the top hand actually stays centered at the hip. And it only comes out, let's say, if they're to pick up a pass, but then it goes immediately back in to the hip. So it's like, look at where his top hand is the whole time. It's like, even right here, it doesn't really come out, doesn't come out. It just shifts from hip to hip. And then finally, when he passes it, it comes out. And then when he, at the same time that he relaxes and, let's say, doesn't get into that hockey stance, look at where his top hand is, right at the side of his hip, even his other hand too. So what's happening here? It's the principle of centrifugal force. It's the same thing that you see with figure skaters, where if you have your hands out here and they're trying to spin, they're going to spin slow. But if you bring your hands in tight, they're going to spin faster. You're going to see the same centrifugal force theme in both the skating and shooting, which is why this is a pillar of movement for hockey. But that is something to note. These guys keep their top hand close to their body way more often than they take it out of their body. The second pillar to note is what you see with their ankles. The best players will actually bend their ankles way more often than you think, even though that's something that's mocked in the hockey sphere. It's actually something you see all the time with these best players, where their toe caps will basically get to the ice. And this is actually going to tie into some other pillars too, but basically what you want to see, yeah, watch this left foot with McDavid right here, even though like that isn't the foot that he's cutting off of. And that by that, I mean, it's not the foot that's he has all his weight on. He has all of his weight on his right foot. And the way that you can tell that is the way that his body is going and arcing towards the left. But really, like, you can see this ankle right here fully collapsed onto the ice. And even like a little bit with that right foot, if you can kind of see it underneath, this isn't the best view. But really, like, this is a good one too. Watch the left foot again. You can even watch the right foot too. Those toe caps are very close to the ice. If we get something that's even closer too, like something right here, look at how bendy those ankles get. Even something, you can see it really quickly before it gets covered by that player. Watch that left foot. You can see even a little articulation between the ankle and then the lower leg. So to say that these guys are benders or that to make fun of people for that, I think is a mistake. If you have the control that he does with these bendy ankles, well, you're going to end up skating much more like him than anyone else. So that's another principle movement that makes skating work in hockey, and that I wish I knew when I was younger. Here's a third one. We're going to cover shin angle, which is the relation of the lower leg to the ankle. And it's a much more precise definition on what exactly knee bend is. So more often than not, you're told to just bend your knees when you're skating, bend your knees when you're skating, bend your knees when you're skating, just to like keep yourself in that position, bend your knees when you're skating. Well, There's a problem with that. If you look at the kinesiology and the anatomy of people, there's two ways to bend your knees. One is that you push your hips back, and two is that you push your knees forward. So if we took a look at this clip in a closer detail, maybe like right here, as McDavid's finishing this cross under, we'll call it, look how far his knee is over his toe. Is his knee bent? Like, is that, let's say, good knee bend, even though he's kind of, you could make the case that he's kind of upright in that position. Even something like right here, watch it before the camera switches. Would you say that this is pretty upright for a player? I would think so. That seems to be too upright. They're not in the traditional, let's just bend over and like get to work, you know, traditional knee bend that you would see from like the power skating coaches. But you will still see, even on an angle like this, that the knee is going over the toe on both sides, actually. So that is what's referred to as shin angle. Now, what this does, and I have some clips of this with some kids, actually. What happens here is that when your knee goes over your toe in your skates, you actually move forward without any extra effort. So the reason for that actually goes into our next pillar, which is called heel pressure. So if your weight is at your toes, or if your weight is further back without the shin angle, let's just say you get the knee bend with the hips being pushed back instead of the knees being pushed forward, you're not going to move forward on the ice without any extra like pushing or things that take a lot of effort. But if you get your knees forward with the heel being down on the ice, you are going to move forward. And the reason that you need your heel down on the ice is because, let's just say this is what gets into the biggest fundamental difference between walking on ground and walking on ice. If you use your toes like you normally would on ice, you actually would end up slipping. So that means you cannot use your toes how you were, like, let's just say, biomechanically brought up from generation to generation for however long humans have existed. It doesn't even work that great on, let's just say, traditional shoes. If you get like a glass surface ice area and you try to push with your toes, eventually you will end up slipping. It's the same thing that happens with these skates. That is why, let's say, I'm not a fan of the toe flick. Because you will see more often, and this kind of ties back to the first point where these guys are gliding more often than they're pushing. If these crosses were what you would see traditionally taught as a crossover, where people just stay on the blue line and put one foot over the other, and they don't actually move forward like you see here. He's only taken five crosses. If you taught it like you normally would, you wouldn't move this distance. Plus, he went around a massive arc on just five steps. So what is going on? And those traditional crossovers, by the way, they're taught to use the toe. So if McDavid's moving this much without using toe pressure, then how is he moving? The only other explanation for that is to say that he's using heel pressure plus shin angle. Those two go together wonderfully. Now, let's see if we can get another corkscrew clip, as this goes into one of the final pillars. And that is called rocker. I'm going to bring up McKinnon again. So rocker details out the skate blade profile, because the skate blades are shaped like the bottom of a coin or the bottom of a boat. Like a few of those analogies work for understanding the concept behind this. And this clip actually shows it wonderfully, what the heck's going on. So what you're going to notice here is that there's very little pushing especially when it's at the speed that it is here. Like those little things, if they were pushes, they would look so much different. You would see the toe basically flick out, the feet externally rotate, and I would suspect he would slip up and fall over. But you actually don't see that. What you see with this little wiggle, which is what we call rocker, is that he actually doesn't lose balance, and that's what allows him to make the deke. How can you stay balanced if it's supposed to be a push and he's not falling over? Like what's going on there? It has to be the opposite. It has to be internal rotation, which you kind of see. It's hard to see from a side angle, but if you really think about it, the opposite of external rotation is internal rotation. It's like, so that has to be the case here. The opposite of a push is a twist. It's not a push. It's a little twist. That's also what you see in a little clip right here. But rocker also applies to when your feet do lift off the ice, like what you saw with the McDavid clip here. I'm going to show a different one just so we get some variety. And by the way, there's a big difference too between what you see on the camera here, which does tell a lot even if you know what to look for. But there's still a difference between what you see and what you actually put into practice and what you teach your body to do. So what may look like a push, let's say with his back foot, so that right foot, what may look like a kick up may actually be something different when you go out and actually test it. Because if you were to try to do a toe flick the same way that he did here, and you did your traditional hard toe flick, maybe you wouldn't move the same way. Maybe it'd be completely different. Maybe you'd fall over. But what you can say is that there's a strike right here. While this blade moves from that point on the ice to that point on the ice before he switches to the toe, let's say, and the same thing happens on this left skate from there to about there, same thing happens on the right skate. There's a bit of a glide and then it lifts off. There's a glide and then it lifts off. A glide and then it lifts off. That doesn't usually work if you just used your toes. And that's basically the problem that I have with the toe flick, is that one, it doesn't feel right. Two, it doesn't look right. I think we just cracked a little code here. It's like what you might see in maybe these like one or two frames, you forget to look at where his feet actually started and ended. You got to remember that there's a glide here. And remember that the principle that we have to have heel pressure in order to do any sort of glide in hockey. There's the glide. It stays on the ice. It's not lifting off. It's not lifting off. It's not lifting off. It lifts off right there. How is that using the toe? If you know the physics of the skate blade, if you know the physics of a skate boot, if you know the physics of a foot, if you know the physics of how the knee relates to the ankle and relates to the hips or whatever it is, if you know how all of that works, you know that this is not a traditional push or toe flick as you would normally see, say, if you were even running, which that could even be debated too. But that is what rocker is. Now, one of the last pillars is the type of footwork that you can name out and distinguish, which gets into a common language. If you're able to name the different footwork that you see, which is what Train 2.0 does a great job of, you're better able to distinguish it for yourself when you go out to practice these movements. So if we looked at this one with McDavid, we see he's doing a couple of cross-unders, a little stutter right there. Cross-unders paired with a little stutter or stride, whatever you want to call it, and then he ends with a little anchor. And if we go to a McKinnon clip, something like this one, like little stutter stride across, corkscrew, anchor, goes to his backhand. What this allows you to do, naming the footwork, is that it takes something that looks amazing, that looks like what you would see in every single highlight film, and it better allows you to dissect what exactly is going on with these guys. Again, this doesn't have to be 100% accurate as to what they're doing. It's because, oh, you're missing the situation. Oh, you're missing what they're thinking. You can't read their mind. It's like, of course that matters. But again, I'm talking about learning their movement. And when you learn their movement, you have to look at their footwork. And that is how you look at their footwork. You have common language for different movements, different skills. You connect that with what it looks like and what you unconsciously learn in all your patterns, because that is how we actually learn kinesthetically. And then you go actually act upon it. That is why footwork's important. Now, the last one is cadence. Cadence is a very common one, especially with like running and different ways to pace yourself, and let's just say a bike race or even just anything like that. It's a measure of rhythm. Cadence is a measure of rhythm. I'll just let you observe some of these clips to see what I mean by that. But you'll see some people who are like starting out who won't actually be in a set rhythm or a set smooth motion. It's kind of like they're stuck. They're very stuck in a set movement and they don't know how to free themselves up. But what rhythm does is that it allows you to match your footwork and to match every other pillar that you work on and that you master with all of your movements on the ice. And basically it just works with anything that you do too. This is a more precise definition on what it's like to have fast feet, which has its own place, and we'll cover more in the video that covers the faster feet. Everything that these guys do is in a set rhythm, even though it may seem like it's something that's a little random and up to chance. Actually, like everything here is in a set routine. Like those stick handles are all in the rhythm. It's like 1-2, 1-2, 1-2. That's in a set rhythm. The same thing happens with McDavid's cross under. His cadence is at 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2. It's at a specific rhythm. His feet always move at the same pace. Even when he was going through all of his different footwork, feet were moving at a very set and rhythmic movement and beat and cadence. So that's the principles behind cadence. Now, my progressions with teaching players how to skate is I always have them start with this little corkscrew that you see McKinnon do here. But before he scores, it's this little one here. I'm gonna show a separate clip of what the corkscrew actually is. That is the foundational mechanic. You just get into a wide stance, you get on your inside edges, let the ankles collapse, let the knees go forward. Keep your hand in the Crosby crevice, weight to your heels. What I do after that is I get people to feel the anchor, which is very similar to the corkscrew, except what you see with McKinnon here, where there's a little bit of toe lifting off the ice, and it acts exactly what the name suggests as an anchor. It actually guides your body directly around. What I do after that is I go to a 10 and 2 on the boards so that people can notice that a movement like that doesn't actually require too much mobility, but it just requires soft ankles, knee over the toe, weight to the heels, and stepping from foot to foot. Instead of a traditional mohawk like it's taught in figure skating, what you see with a lot of these players is that they'll still step foot to foot, again, with all the other pillars that we covered. And then, and only then, that's when I get to outside edge work, which I do along the boards also. Obviously, everyone starts out in different places, and that's the genius of customized coaching or in-person coaching. It's like people are on their own journeys. You're here to help them. It's like, that is true that people start in different places. Then figuring out their progressions is what makes a good coach. Once they've gotten comfortable with all nine base mechanics, so you got, what is it? Corkscrew, 10 and 2, anchor, soft drag, stutter, outside edge roll, shuffle, punch turn, cross under. That's when we ramp up the intensity with what I'm calling dense for ice. Now, dense is an every minute on the minute method pioneered by Keegan Smith at both ATG for Coaches and Uncommon Success. Dense is also a pioneer program inside of ATG online coaching. And I'm taking it to on ice hockey training. What this does is that it's fantastic for individual work. Let's just say you're by yourself, and this is exactly what all my practices look like now. Let's just say you're by yourself. What you get to do now is set a set amount of time, and you get to do a lot of reps. So a lot of my programs are 10 sets of anywhere between 5 reps to sometimes 20 reps in about a 10-minute period. So let's just give an example. It's 10 sets of 5 shots in 10 minutes. You do your 5 shots, and then you rest the remainder of the minute. When the next minute rolls around, you do another 5 shots, rest the remainder of the minute. The next minute, same thing. Next minute, same thing, until you reach that 10-minute threshold. So now what this does is it allows you to get 50 shots in 10 minutes. I like to do this after people and players have gotten comfortable with these movements, because this is kind of a conditioning method, actually. If we applied this to weightlifting, there'd be even more of a conditioning effect. But even in something like moving in the sport of hockey, or in the context of hockey, or like a hockey player, you are going to get some conditioning effects. You are going to be out of breath from this. It is going to be harder to execute the mechanics because of that reason. So this methodology is terrific, let's say, if you want to like hone in or like put a staple down on your movement. If you're learning movement, you would have to do something else. But this is what dense does really well. After people have gotten good with doing dense on ice with just the base 9 fundamental mechanics, I then introduce dense mechanic stack. So that's pairing about, let's say, 3 to 5 mechanics together in a stack. And what this does is that it actually improves in-game transferability and, you know, how these movements transfer to a game-like setting. Because actually in a game, you're not just doing one set mechanic. You're doing multiple mechanics paired together. And it's the same exact methodology where you're doing lots of reps in little time. Now, what I have after that as a third progression, if people want to keep pursuing the dense methodology, is advanced mechanic stacks, which focus a lot more on increasing the cadence of the movement. And it also requires that you take footage of an NHLer, just like we did here, and you match movement by movement and footwork by footwork what they do. This is where I made the biggest improvement in my movement training on the ice, matching exactly how these players move. Now we're bringing it into a strategic methodology where, let's say you do that McDavid clip I showed you. You do that 10 times in 10 minutes. It's like, well, you got 10 repetitions in on exactly what that movement is. It's like, are you going to end up looking like him a lot more? It's like, of course you are. So that's the progressions that I have for skating. Now, I want to add one more thing, which is that there are skating standards that we've created. Say, for example, like the fastest lap, or maybe like a goal line to blue line test, or maybe some other things that you see in different NHL combines. What we've created is standards for each individual base mechanic. So you have the nine fundamental mechanics that each have their own set of standards in them, which include, let's say, being able to get double shoulder width. You're able to do this in both a circle and in a stationary form. You can do it linearly. You can do it in infinity flow. You can do it with 150 BPM cadence. Like things like that are all part of the standards course inside of this hockey hack system. What the standards do is that they're not meant to be absolutes, but they're meant to be estimates for matching the movements of hockey's greatest players today. And what this also does is that it gives you something to aim for and to realize what you can become. That is the genius behind standards. So that is my progressions. We have people start out in the one mechanic that makes everything else easier or necessary. So that's the corkscrew. And then we expand off of there once they start to get more comfortable. Everyone progresses at their own rates. And then once they've gotten pretty good at the base nine fundamental mechanics, that is when we start to ramp things up. And after that, we then pursue the standards to matching the mechanics of the best players, to matching the skating mechanics of the best players. So this skating video I know is pretty long, but there is a wealth of importance behind skating because that actually feeds into everything else that we're doing. Skating actually affects your shooting. Skating actually affects your stick handling. Skating, in a way, can affect your work in the gym. Skating actually affects your faster first steps. The only thing that it might not affect is the structural balance, which I think the structural balance affects the skating more than the skating affects the structural balance, but they still will help each other out or downgrade each other, say, if you're not structurally balanced, much like I was. That is also why this video is first. This is part one in my 5-part series into everything I wish I knew about hockey when I was 12 years old, giving that away to you for free. If you would like my coaching, you can check out the Hockey Hack system in the link below. It's a year-round system designed to fit with your off-season, mid-season, pre-season training camp, playoff push, you name it. It covers your entire year. It's a 52-week program with both off-ice work and on-ice work. It's designed to fit with your season in both where you have to grind things out and where you can take more time to yourself. It accompanies all of that. I also have a zero equipment solution. It's a 12-week program. Say if like you had no equipment and you need to get some conditioning in, that is an option for you too. And I also do custom one-on-one coaching to fit whatever personal needs you have. And even though the cost seems high, there is much more potential to accelerate you to where you want to go because you have that much more attention with me one-on-one. So thanks for watching and I'll see you in the next video.